Okay, so today we're going to do my spoiler-free review on Dead House Gates by Stephen Erickson, book number 2 in Malazan, Book of the Fallen. So, let's get into it. If you are new here, if you want to hear more of my Malazan thoughts, I have a playlist. It has my spoiler-free review for the first book and a spoiler vlog. And on the same day that I'm posting this, I should also be posting my spoiler vlog for Dead House Gates. So, like I do in a lot of my videos, I just want to talk at the top, no context. What was my experience? Did I like this book? And I did. I liked this book more than I liked Gardens of the Moon overall. So Gardens of the Moon, I had a very varied experience. I went from like 4.5 stars to 3 stars, back up to 4 stars. It was a mini roller coaster of experiences, whereas Dead House Gates was a 4-star book pretty much the entire time. It's probably for a couple reasons. One, it's my second Malazan book, so I kind of had a better idea of how I need to read them for my enjoyment versus Gardens of the Moon. I knew it was going to be dense, I knew it was going to be different, but I didn't understand that it wasn't going to be the same type of reading experience. And what I mean by that is, I personally cannot binge these out. I know people who can. For me, they are dense enough that I really can, at most, read 40 to 60 pages of the mass market paperback a day, which is like a small amount for me. Normally, like if I'm reading The Mistborn mass market paperback, I can easily read 100 or so pages of that a day. It flies by for me because of the writing style differences. So when I picked up Dead House Gates, I knew going into it, only read like 40 pages a day, maybe a chapter a day, because chapters in these books are notoriously long. And so going into this one knowing it's taking the whole month versus Gardens of the Moon being like, not knowing it was going to consume so much of my time, I think helped, just like a different expectation. But also, I just do think this book is more consistently paced for what it is, but both of them have great payoff. I do think I like the Gardens of the Moon ending a hair more than this one, which I think is an unpopular opinion, but I was so happy with the ending of Gardens of the Moon, guys. Like, I just felt so accomplished when I finished that book, and I felt similarly here, but I don't know, it's just if I had to pick, I like the other one a little better. So that's like my experience, how I went into reading it. I gave it 4 stars. I really liked it. Like, for me, if you're new here, that's a pretty good rating for a fantasy book. And let's get into a brief synopsis. This won't spoil Gardens of the Moon, but it just gives you an idea, even if you've finished Gardens of the Moon, where the series goes next. So this is a very large world. This book takes place primarily on the continent of the Seven Cities. And we are basically on the eve of rebellion in this area. And so we are following characters at different angles of this very large historical event. We have people who are on the military of the conquerors, so the people are rebelling against. We have just some travelers. We have people who have their own agenda against the empire, doing their own thing. We have some people who just want to get home. We have people who have been sold into slavery and just want to not be there anymore and are adjusting. And you follow all these people and you're learning about the situation. We continue to learn about the magic through all of these lenses. And I think the character work and like the character relations were done in a much stronger way this book for me. One of my small complaints for Gardens of the Moon was I wanted more character interactions on page. I felt like I got a few, but not enough to my taste, which my taste with books is I love character interactions. Give me all the character dialogue. I want to see them talk. I want to see the banter. I love it. I love friendships. I love contentious relationships. I love them all so long as they're on page and I just get to watch the drama unfurl. And I think that happens way better for me here in Dead House Gates than it did in Gardens of the Moon. I also, surprisingly, this is in both my likes and kind of dislikes, the military fantasy execution, because this is very much military fantasy. The first book has military fantasy components, but it's more of like a heisty military jack of all trades epic fantasy. Gardens of the Moon has a lot of moving bits. This one is majority of it, you could say like 60-70% of it, military fantasy. And I'm not a military fantasy reader. It's not my bread and butter. I don't care much about the actual battles most of the time. I'm not that big into strategy and tactics while I read. I like it on screen, so like visual fantasy, I'm cool with military fantasy, but like in my reading experience, it's not my bread and butter. That said, although like I said, this is pro and con for me, the points of the book that dragged a bit for me or were harder to read because of content or pacing were the military fantasy moments. But the payoff for that part of the book was so strong. So strong. Like, there's kind of the military fantasy point, and then there's the everyone's just trying to figure out their life point for various reasons. I'm just being vague. Everyone, like, has their own agenda, and they're just trying to figure it out, and there's magic and gods and, you know, wonderful fantastical nonsense. So they're just trying to figure it out. Normally, I care a lot about that intrigue. I care a lot about those characters. But by the end of the book, the ending parts that I cared about the most were how the arc of the military fantasy part wrapped up. It was so well done. So although I don't think the execution maybe was my favorite thing, probably because it's not my favorite content in general, if he didn't have that setup at the beginning, I don't know if I would have had that payoff. And slowly but surely, I was understanding how these sections worked. I was understanding where to put my focus in these conversations, how to piece apart all these conversations. Now, something I think that would have helped me a lot with the military fantasy was a little bit more help with the political world building. I know he's not a world builder that likes to spoon feed things to you, but I would have liked a little bit more help. Like, right at the beginning, it was really hard for me to really tell who was against who and why, which for me is, like, really important when I'm reading a war story or any contentious thing in a city. These are always my questions when I'm in, like, a pseudo-civil war situation is, like, who's against who, why, how did we get here? Okay, now we're here, where do we go? And I just think that part could have been done just a little better, but it wasn't too bad. And by the end of the book, I understood what was going on. But it was probably something that prevented me from being as into the military fantasy parts as early as I could be. Another thing that I personally really loved in this book, more so than Gardens of the Moon, but was in Gardens of the Moon, the humor. Oh my goodness. Was I chuckling so much? Like, I wasn't, like, laughing. I don't laugh a lot out loud when I read, but this was one of the first times where, as I was reading, I actually took notes in the book. I had, like, a pencil so I could, like, talk to myself and, like, ask myself questions, basically, because there's a lot happening and I get confused, especially with, like, the political world building stuff I talked about. So I would write myself, like, wait, who is he mad at? Or I would try and, like, connect dots for myself in the text just to keep me engaged with those slower parts, because a lot of the politics and stuff was in the military fantasy part. But also, I would just write LOL if something was funny, you know, it's quickhand. I wrote that so many times in so many sections, and there's a whole contingent of the Malazan army that are my children and that I love, and those are the sappers. They're amazing. So if you don't know, because I didn't know, sappers are actually, I think, like, the engineering part of a military. I don't know a lot about military in general, but because when I read the first book, I thought this was a made-up word for this world. It's not. It's used in the real world. I looked it up. I actually learned about it on a Discord because someone said, as a former sapper. So it's a real occupation, and they are in charge of a lot of, sometimes bombs, sometimes building things. Like, they're the engineers. And this group of people... I love them. They're so funny. They're so sassy. They're great. I love them so much. I also really love the humor with some of the animals. Like, there are animals that do things, and I'm just like, what? I had so much fun with some of the deadpan humor. And it happened a lot in the military fantasy part. So like I said, there's a lot in those parts that I really liked. Like, there are these different cultural groups. One's the Wiccans, and they have, like, a real, like, deadpan humor. And it was real funny to me. So for me, it worked well. Humor's subjective. Take this with a grain of salt. It's also, like, I know I like the humor in Sanderson books. It's nothing like the humor in Sanderson books. So don't, like, equate my like of the humor in Sanderson books to my like of the humor here. They're not the same. Very, very different humor. I also really loved a lot of the themes in this work. I was talking to my friend Brittany from Books with Brittany. Chances are, if you're here, you've seen her channel. She has a lot of great Malazan videos, though, so if you have not seen her channel, I'll have her link down below. But she was asking me, what is a word I would use to describe the themes in this? And that was a really hard question, because it's an 800-some-page book, and there's a lot going on. There's a lot of moving parts. And I think loyalty and honor were really big in this book, for lots of reasons, and just the idea of we're gonna do what's right no matter how hard it is. And that's where a lot of the emotional impact comes from, is seeing these people being put in all these situations and having to do the right thing because that's what they believe in. And the loyalty, like I was talking about character relationships, there's a friendship in this story That is so much that I was invested in at the beginning. And it's another source of humor for me. And I love those two. It's Mappo and Icarium. They're everything to me. That arc. Anyways. So, you know, just these themes and the depth of the relationships are all things I really, really liked in this. Now, I do have some minor complaints. There were some character decisions at the end of this book that I talk about in detail in my spoiler vlog that, for the reasons I say in the spoiler vlog, I don't understand or agree with, or I felt were very abrupt, or we took a left, we like swerved really quick. And I think that's part of why this ending is just not as strong for me as Gardens of the Moon, but like, it's not a big deal, and I'm sure in future works I will understand more why people did what they did. It's just more like, right now, I don't feel it. So those are my thoughts on Dead House Gate, spoiler free. If you had a rough time with Gardens of the Moon, this is definitely, I feel, more straightforward. You get to follow, like, basically, I think it's three or four groups of people. Like, if you've seen Infinity Wars, when you get, like, people get sectioned off and you're following these different threads, but they're all connected. It's kind of like that. It's not like Gardens of the Moon, where you literally have, like, 30 named important characters, which I can understand is a little hard to juggle. This is a lot easier. You basically just have, like, four main angles, and you almost always visit each angle in each chapter. So you don't go too long without checking in with a certain angle on the situation. I think you get a lot of really cool reveals that help things from Gardens of the Moon already start to make sense. Like, I know there's so much further to go in this series in terms of me understanding things, but you do get some really helpful, awesome reveals in this. And I, as another positive, his reveals are great. I love them. I love how he decides to reveal information to me. It's been great. Would I like it more? Yes. All the information. I want all the knowledge in my head. So I do think you would maybe like this more than Gardens of the Moon if that was your issue with Gardens of the Moon. If you're not as into military fantasy, if you like more of the cool, flashy fantasy, I think that's lesser here to some extent than the first book, although there's still so much cool magic, so much disturbing magic at times. Like, it still leans into magic's awesome, we're having it in the fantasy book, which I love. There's still so much lore and discussion of the lore of this world, which is something I really like. Like, it really does feel like you are reading a modern Greek story, which I feel like a lot of people talk about, and I do think is an influence of Erikson. I'm unsure. But it really does feel like, you know, the Trojan War, where you have a war of people. It's really about people and human suffering, but the gods are kind of involved, and they're involved in pretty cheeky ways. Like, it's kind of like that. And so, yeah, I don't know. I really liked it. I'm really excited for Memory of Ice, you know, once my brain recharges, because these are still work. It has a lot of cool stuff, but I personally have to work quite hard for it. And I don't mind putting in the work because, like I said, both this book and Gardens of the Moon, the payoff's been great for me. Like, I mean, obviously mileage varies for everyone, but I'm excited. I'm excited to see what happens, especially since everyone keeps telling me Memories of Ice is going to blow my mind, or that I'm going to love it based off what they think of my reading tastes. So I'm excited. But that's it for this one. If you made it this far and want to leave me an emoji, leave me like a monkey emoji. I think that only makes sense if you've read the book, but I would like a monkey emoji. And otherwise, like if you liked it, subscribe if you want to, and I'll see you in the next one. Bye.